Thank you. Okay, so tell me, if today, whatever NPTEL has developed, a private person wants to kind of make it more appealing, can you do that? Can you do that?
That is,
can do
the
it.
Consensus was that we should enable that.
No, no, but now they can do it. I think we took that decision in one of our last meetings.
Yeah. No, we cannot do it.
No, we cannot do it.
No, it is under NC. Unless it is permission is given,
yeah.
So when the mission started, so
let's listen to it.
So the mission started, then the different institutions came up with a different policy on the content. However, it was said clearly in the mission that the copyrights belong to HRD Ministry.
Yeah.
So sir, then there were a lot of opinions on that. Last PAB meeting, you asked us to detail examine this issue. So now we have prepared a draft policy.
Yeah.
So we are coming back. So we consulted large number of stakeholders. We consulted COL also on this. So we are coming back on PAB, sir, which we are scheduling in third week of March. Where we have now, then we will come with the policy, get it approved with the PAB. We have also consulted large number of stakeholders who have created this content. Yeah. And once that policy is out, then A, we will share with all our stakeholders who have created this content. B, our plan is, sir, we'll also have a workshop, and the big players who are in this business of creating e-content, we'll share our policy with that.
Okay.
And the idea is, that as you are saying every time, sir, is that we have prepared the basic content, and the modification or addition should be done by the private players, primarily so that it reaches a large number of users. In fact, one of the discussion in the first group yesterday also was that the government can always make the basic content. They can make it available and make use of the private players. For example, the comparison which they were making was, however good Doordarshan can be, it can never reach NDTV or whatever it is. So idea is that we have to involve everybody in so that we reach to the students with the best possible content.
In this today's August gathering, is there anybody who has any objection to making it open, or another point of view which?
Everybody
agrees.
Yeah.
So that's a good thing, I think. We should go ahead with that. So with your permission, I will.
So when we are coming in, this is only content. When we are coming in detail to the PAB, we are talking about all different scenarios. It's not content, the technology which we are developing. We'll come up with all different scenarios and. So these all details are there. So I've just told the. All those precautions.
We'll discuss this. We'll discuss this in greater details when the policy is discussed.
Thank you. Now we'll come to the second group. This is group number two, enabling and empowering educators. Professor Pankaj Jalota is not here.
To leave.
Dr. Sujata, TIFR.
She is also not here. Kindly introduce yourself.
Yes, we'll do that.
Good.
Good morning, everyone. We are here to give the recommendations from Group 2, Enabling and Empowering Educators, which was moderated by Professor Pankaj and Dr. Sujata, which is being presented by Professor Sanjay Agarwal from NETAR Bhopal, and I'm Dr. Shraddha Kamar from NIT University, Neemrana. We had a very invigorating and vibrant discussion. It was on enabling and empowering educators. So it was, I think it got extended till a very large extent on how we can actually empower educators. And what was very good was that the focus was on the you know, the opportunities and not on the challenges. We discussed challenges, but we converted them into some kind of stepping stones, which we'll be discussing. The role of an educator has become even more significant now that we talk about integration of ICT and technology. We know that technology is a great leveler and it can reach out to maximum kind of learners, maximum number in terms of quantifying it, and also different kinds of learners. So whether we talk about learning aptitude or different learning styles, technology has the ability to do so. We discussed models of learning across disciplines as an interdisciplinary approach, and some labs and projects that could also be sort of reinvented using ICT, and then specifically how to empower an educator. So I'll request my colleague to start with the recommendations and then I'll join in.
Good afternoon. In this group, we have the task to answer 8 questions. This is enabling and empowering educators. And during the discussion, we came out certain challenges, as Shraddha told you. And then we'll discuss a lot, but at the end, we combined 3-4 questions together. So we came out with the 7 recommendation at all, not question-wise, but in total, we have the 7 recommendation with us. The question was asked, the main concentration of our group was on the first question, there is need to integrate faculty development in technology enhanced teaching learning. And second was the related to that, at what minimum ICT level are to be prescribed for the educator. And the third one also related, means once we start discussing, we find this also can be related together. There is a, will the college teachers be threatened by the introduction of technology that are capable of massive education? And our group worked out in that, and the first recommendation which came out from there is providing adequate support structure to faculty members for embracing technology. This is ensuring they become the independent and self-directed. So this is the first recommendation which came out with that every faculty member should have the minimum level of connectivity, as well as having the infrastructure with them so that he can use freely. As first group recommend, this authoring tool and other tools can also be included in that, so that they feel free to create the content and they feel free to use the content in the classroom situation using ICT, as well as on the web-based or any live medium. This is the first recommendation from our group. Second is, for the existing teachers, the number of teachers in the colleges are very large, as the data is also provided to us. And our group recommendation was that leverage technology for formal training requires training to use technology effectively, using pedagogical approach. Our group recommends this may be a certificate course, duration may be decided later on, but this can be done through, because the number of faculty members are very large, this can be done through virtual mode, blended mode, or what we can do, as knitters are doing, that training, the master trainer can be produced or trained on the face-to-face model, and then they can also train the other teachers at their end. So this model can be applied, but for the existing teacher using ICT tools and technology, this should be there, a formal training should be there. The other recommendation was there that design a mandatory training or induction training program for the new entrants into the higher education. Because the only qualification does not mean he's entitled to become a teacher. He's a M.Tech or PhD. The group discuss a lot in that. So if it's a M.Tech or something, it does not apply that it becomes a teacher. It requires a lot of pedagogical approach, pedagogical training, as Professor Mohan also highlighted in the panel discussion today morning. It requires a lot of training in the pedagogical approach. And this is our experience, and our group also feels that when we go for the ICT-based training using AVU or any other tool, it requires a different style of teaching approach. So definitely it requires a training. This training of ICT tools and training can include the pedagogical approach also. So these are the 3 recommendations. Now, for the other recommendation, I would shut that.
Thank you. So just to re-emphasize, the training should be on the science of learning, because that is something which is right now not being met. And this has to be institutionalized in the sense that if we introduce an incentive process for educators who are able to integrate technology meaningfully in the classroom and demonstrate it, then some link has to be done with their appraisals or something, or some incentive has to be given so that people are encouraged, and people who step out of the status quo and their comfort zone and are doing something which is more research driven should be encouraged. We also discussed that we need to explore ICT for establishing models for collaborative teaching. I think this was a very good discussion, because yes, so NITAR Bhopal, for instance, we are calling, and Chandigarh, we are having subject matter experts who can virtually connect. So if we are teaching a course, then we can have an industry expert who can virtually add some value to the teaching learning process. And we don't have to spend extra sort of money on, you know, bringing somebody to the classroom, because now ICT allows us to sort of have different channels of dissemination. And here specifically, the collaborative teaching model can be developed, which have been demonstrated in many regional institutes. Then allowing a certain amount of autonomy in redesigning curriculum using maximum digital resources could also be implemented, although we leave it to the discretion of the recommendation panel, because there was some discussion on the flexibility of certain curriculums in, you know, because they're affiliated to universities. So therefore, I think assessments was again an important area where we said that a teacher, an educator, in order to have a holistic perspective on how to become more empowered, needs to be adept in content creation, usage of open educational resources, multiple channels of information dissemination, and assessments. Because unless we have this holistic approach towards educators' empowerment, if even there is one missing link, it will be difficult to implement. And the seventh recommendation was to initiate a social network community connect exclusively for higher education. Like, we have a Facebook and an Edmondo, which is a learning platform, or we have LinkedIn, we have micro groups and special interest groups, but can we have a larger body which allows us all to share and be more participative, and especially to come out of the silo-centric mode, which we all feel we should. So these were the recommendations. And on a closing note, we were just wanting to emphasize that a teacher and educator can only be empowered if we are able to create a meaningful difference in learning engagement and effectiveness in the classroom. And for that, a systemic integration model has to be developed. Anything?
Thank you. This is only one recommendation which the group is having certain question mark, that is curriculum design. Including the maximum thing which is related to ICT in the curriculum design. So the autonomy to the college or the university level, this need to be discussed, because the now at present the university is doing all the curriculum design work and assessment work. How can we include this ICT in the curriculum so that effective utilization of this ICT, this is a question mark with our group, sir. Thank you.
And just one last thing with this recommendations, it will be possible for us as educators to become contributors and not just consumers of ICT technology. So that's it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I just make one observation.
Yeah. Yes, please. Since IIT Bombay and now jointly with IIT Kharagpur, we run large-scale teachers training program. We have consistently felt this need, as was mentioned even by Professor Mohan and others, that there should be some mandatory induction training and perhaps a mandatory annual or biannual training as a revision man. In any case, we now realize, we have been realizing it for some time, and we are injecting some elements of pedagogy into our subject-specific training. As you know, our 10,000 teachers training program was originally conceived to be subject-specific training. But we now realize the importance of introducing teachers to the use of ICT and to the use of pedagogy. So I'm glad to announce that we have been including such elements, albeit indirectly, in some of our recent programs. But now onwards, every training program for 10,000 teachers that we conduct will necessarily have these elements, sir.
Just add, sir. So the MOU, as last time in your presence, in Minister's presence, we entered into MOU with State Technical University. And one of the component of the MOU where we are talking about is also exposing to all the lecturers and teachers to this education technology. The second issue, sir, which I also discussed in PAB earlier, that the talk to teacher infrastructure which is available is primarily used during summer vacation and winter vacation. The idea is, sir, to develop NITR as a nodal point. 4 NITRs will be the nodal point, and all the 400 remote centers which have been created in the talk to teacher program will be used extensively for doing this education technology training to all the lecturers and teachers. Doing that, sir, that our effort was to see that this network which has been created, this infrastructure which has been created under this 10 to 10,000 teachers
is maximally utilized.
So that's our attempt.
We also asked this question, Master, what are we doing with it? We try to use weekend courses and so on, but this suggestion makes it full use across.
Now I request the third group, content delivery.
Dr. Lina
Waria and Professor Uma Kanjilal.
So I think first we should say thank you to our rapporteurs, Satish Sangameshwaran from Microsoft and Sri Pradeep Kaul. They did a brilliant job, so we had absolutely no work to do. So we were very lucky, so thank you both very much. Our group had about 24 attendees, and I'm not going to go by the question sequence because I've sort of tried to club things in terms of the title was content delivery and usage. So I'll separate out the delivery discussion and the usage discussion. So the first question was on the issue of delivery, that DTH is available, MOOC platforms are available. How do you think about the trade-off between coverage versus effective use? And I'm essentially saying exactly how our rapporteurs wrote it down. The industry view was, and that was a surprise at the very beginning, that e-learning has not worked. And their point of view was that there is not enough student stickiness and motivation, there's not enough teacher connect, and there's not enough back channels to help students stay motivated through the course. And for example, Microsoft said that they got better results when they continuously interacted with the students through some of their modules, right? But the academic perspective was that there are even practical considerations on the ground, like the EDUSAT model. Somebody said that we don't even know what router to buy, what equipment to buy, and even that becomes a roadblock in us accepting technologies for use. So, and then the other point which naturally came up and which has overlapped with what has gone in the two previous groups and in the next group is the issue of acceptability from faculty. And then Uma, as a member of Sakshat, sort of cautioned all of us that, teachers play a critical role. And because they play a critical role, I'm just going to expand on what was discussed there, that, they need training, they need incentivization to use these materials. The other thing was that, in the first question itself, it came up that, somehow e-learning courses have to be made mandatory if we are going to have to drive adoption. Maybe think of making 10% of the courses to be taken through e-learning methods and so on. Or certainly you must incentivize students by giving them credit. So that was important too. And then in the context of DTH, there was a lot of discussion, and the thinking was that, who is DTH targeted towards? Is it the students who are already in the classroom? Or are they students who are watching at home? And if they are watching at home, when will they watch? In what time slots? So the cautionary statement was that one needs to think that DTH through very carefully how we use it. For example, the example of, I think Mr. Praveen was in the room at that point, and he said that, one set of target audience could be students who have no classroom experience. or in open university courses, or for remedial teaching, and so on. So we decided at that point that, look, we are discussing infrastructure. We don't need to say how the infrastructure will be used, but we do want to caution that, you know, somehow the DTH has to be thought through so that it is maximally useful to everyone. And yes, we would certainly like to say that experiments like DTH, online MOOCs, etc., on delivery platforms have to get started, and we can make corrections as we go along. And at that point, Kannan was in the room, and he clarified some of the questions that were on our group, where he posed this question that if we are concerned about the percentage of students who finish a course online, then should we even consider putting in a small filter, a simple filter, not very difficult, but some test of the student's intention to try to complete the course. And so that created a lot of discussion. And I think, the general feeling was that no, any filtering goes against the philosophy of online courses and MOOCs, and so it's better to try to do whatever you want to do post the course is over. So at least that's what most members of our team felt. Better to filter at exit stage than at pre-filter. And if we are concerned about students finishing the course, then let's look at other ways to help students stay incentivized to complete the course, which includes, assistance and support through social media, course credit, certification, and so on. Just to close the DTH discussion, I think there was very clear thinking that DTH needs to be used. I just want to reiterate that. I've written it down here. And in the context of usage, I think several thoughts came in, and, we took cognizance of the fact that the reason why we in India want to use MOOCs and online education is slightly different from why they're doing it in the West. For us, we absolutely, absolutely need it to extend reach and to help improve quality, because it's a new tool and, you know, we can rethink the way we do things. And therefore, in that context, we discussed usage issues, and I think one important suggestion came from Rajasthan Technical University, saying that, you know, going online has to be a phased approach, an inclusive approach. It will take time, and that we have to all get started, but wait a bit. And then the other thinking was that the dynamic between universities and affiliating colleges will play a very, very important role in the extent of usage of online technologies. We didn't elaborate on that, but And again, integration with the curriculum will make it easier to get buy-in from teachers, students, and administrators in the university system. And one specific suggestion that came was that perhaps regulating agencies could say that, you know, if there is online material available, then that should be referred to in the course syllabus somehow, so that it becomes, at least there is a pointer to the online material for the students, and then which can perhaps drive absorption. And yes, the consistent certification and maybe recognition of the online course as on par with the classroom course is very critical. And for that, of course, it means that we have to do online courses with high quality, but if you could make it on par, then certainly it will drive usage. And there is a strong need to practice flipped classroom models, because then one can make maximal use of contact hours to emphasize the learning outcomes. And in terms of content, I think people felt that, you know, some kind of wiki type model where people can vet and comment and review and content would be a good idea. And so there we go straight into some of the issues of content. There's some overlap with previous groups. The question from the private sector was that, what about all the content that is available with the private sector? How can it be made relevant to students? And so I think Uma came up with the statement that Sakshat is going to become a content repository. And then this started a flurry of discussion on if it's a content repository, what is needed. And that included the Wikipedia discussion, but it also included things like, you know, insisting that people who create content file the content with appropriate meta tags and indexing and you know all syllabus information and so on, so that it becomes easier for students to find it. And also that there must be community rating mechanisms. We are now familiar with Amazon rating and YouTube rating and so on, and so those need to get incorporated into any content repository that is created. But a content repository is a very good idea, so that a lot of content can come in, and you know, we'll get to see that where the gaps are. And I think this brings us to two very important recommendations that we have, and I'm going to say them both quickly. I'll let Uma expand on it, because one of them was her own suggestion, which we thought was a very good idea. And she said that, you know, we need some kind of sustainable, long-term engagement with this whole process of online education. It has to be somebody's responsibility to coordinate, to share, to keep resources fresh, and so on. And she felt that, you know, NME ICT is a project, Sakshat is a portal, but there should be some organizational structure that takes care of this to ensure longevity as well as more use. It has to be somebody's business to disseminate what is learned from these things. So this is one major thing that we have. And the other statement that we'd like to make is that I think there should be some technology-enabled learning-related policy that helps to sort of deal with all the crux issues, like how do you incentivize teachers? What happens to their API scores? Hemlata brought it up a little earlier. And how do you give credits to students and so on? That needs to be discussed.
Would you like to add something more? Yeah, just 2 points. I think that's not required. One is, like, see, when we talk about content delivery, we are talking about multiple platforms. But we have to remember that teacher is one. And already we are talking about shortage of teachers. Now, how do you expect a teacher to go in for different platforms and delivering? So can we not think in terms of maybe a single delivery point, but distribute in different platforms? That is something we need to look into, how we have convergence of technology, convergence of media for the delivery purposes. That is something we need to look into. And the idea about this sustainable model, it is perhaps Western world, we have something like a consortia where, I mean, we can group together people to, I mean, efforts that are there for delivery. And similar thing was started in the name of Meta University. Perhaps that sort of a model we can think of, where we offer programs from different universities and have a credit system there. I mean, a bouquet of courses can be offered, and from that platform, if we can have online programs available. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Any observation, any clarification?
I just wanted to note that I'm very happy that they said things which under NME ICT, IIT Bombay is going to launch from this July. As some of you might have read my paper, so the two courses that IIT Bombay will be offering will both permit recognition of the online course grade, except that we are also asking the local college teachers who will be the helpers to the students in the flipped classroom model to contribute to the evaluation. And that would be recognized by the university, so there is no double work. It's one of the reasons why people drop out. There's only one problem. It's not like a giving a choice. They will not have a choice of giving the regular conventional old style exams. They will be studying only this. And of course, we'll be, as I mentioned, we'll be training teachers extensively. And thanks to the inputs from all of you, now we'll be explicitly building in pedagogical training into that training.
So this is regarding, because Lina mentioned my name, just wanted to mention, this is based on the observation about our own teaching program. Massive teaching programs. It is not clear how many people are not serious about the program, and they still come and attend. And basically, we are wasting money on them. So, can we come up with some entry barriers, in the sense that demonstrate that you are serious about the program, because the government is going to spend a lot of money, and then you come over. So. Basically, this suggestion, although was not acceptable to this cotton delivery group, the educators group thought it was a great idea. They thought that maybe one third of the people have, you know, minimal, you know, make available learning material. It could be recorded material like Khan Academy, spoken tutorial. It could be web material, books. Let them learn. Simple test. Let them score 20 marks. We are not talking about grade filtering. And then so that the troublemakers are removed. They don't come. So the everybody who comes there is already at some level. Then we can actually conduct this program at a much higher level. We could even have it in a flipped classroom. People can bring their problems to be solved. The same problem can get analyzed from 100 different angles. And more the students, more the participants, the quality can actually be higher. So that was the proposal I made. But the educators, the previous one, thought it was a good idea, and they have accommodated.
So you may call the last.
Thank you. Now.
I just wanted to say, Lina, that you preempted us from saying something which we are going to include in the Mumbai statement, you know. You'll hear about it soon.
Now we come to the last group. This is on assessment, certification and policy. Dr. P. Anandan.
He is left, but Sanjay is
going. Okay. So there are two people, Sanjay and Venki. I would request both of them, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. Honorable Secretary Saab, Patak Saab, Prakash Ji, and Pawan Ji, thank you very much for giving this honor to speak before you and try to consolidate what has been done by the group. Especially, I would like to first thank Dr. Anandan, who was the moderator for this session, and the rapporteurs, Jonathan is here, Radhika, and Mr. Arora. Thank you very much to all of you. I was just a participant in the group, and it was really lively discussion in the group, a lot of discussion. But especially we focused on policy issues. Many of the things that the other three groups have also talked about were also discussed in the group. What I felt is that we were not able to focus largely on assessment and certification issues, which was listed in this. But we discussed more on the policy issues overarching teaching and learning using technology. I take the liberty of some of the things in the order that was discussed. We had 14 questions to reflect upon. And Dr. Anandan made a good framework of 5 to 6 different areas for us to discuss. And we reflected on those areas identified by him. And certain general points that has emerged in this discussion, I'd just like to highlight that not in order of priority, of course. Online education opens the possibility of separating the process of assessment from teaching and learning. Especially, it may be possible to have a more centralized or common set of assessment for different subjects that can be utilized and used by the institutions. Many of these recommendations are very generic. We have not come out with specific things that it should be done. It is a matter of interpretation and look at. For example, assessment, one of the things that we were discussing is that there are different ways how assessment can be done and how open infrastructure for assessment can be established, including using the open badges so that you can incentivize people to use our badges for online learning. The second one is there is a desire to encourage significant use of online learning, especially blended learning methods in higher education, especially for institutions which are facing challenges to meet their teaching and learning needs. It was also discussed that technology may help in customizing the curricula and learning needs of special students in each institution. This is something that we were looking at, trying to reflect on issues related to how much of blended e-learning may be allowed in our educational institutions. I think one group told about 10% mandatory. There is another recommendation somewhere else in the country about 15%. And recently, in the document, it is shown that Dr. Pathak, Professor Pathak, and myself, we are a member of a group who has submitted to UGC to accommodate around 15%. Our group didn't talk about the percentage, but definitely talked about that there has to be some mechanism to give, to encourage teaching and learning, online methods in teaching and learning. There is next issue discussed was regarding open source and rights related to content and technology. I think the first group discussion, and during the first group's presentation, this was much discussed, but I will read what we have almost articulated. In. There are two topics in these issues. One is related to licensing and commercialization rights related to content and technologies created under NMEICT funding. The other is use of open source technologies in creating content and related technologies in NMEICT project. These two are different things. On the first issue, there was a kind of view that the general sentiment was towards that the products developed via public funded should remain in public domain. We are not going by the legalistic definition of public domain here. That the government and government funded institutions should have the right to use, reuse these materials freely. However, it was noted that this issue is not specific to MHRD or NMEICT funded projects, but it is so for all government projects and it should be taken in a global approach. On the second area, the use of open source technologies, the discussion was towards not to specify use of open source alone and therefore leave it as such and encourage use of open source technologies as such. So that's leaving a lot of flexibility in the developments, because I think this is a better way to look at encouraging open source than to fix open source, because appropriate use of technology is more important than specifying something else. The next is that we should incentivize of use of the NMEICT materials. I think many other groups have stalled, and this is also the same thing that came out. We should encourage mechanisms to incentivize use of NMEICT materials that has been created. Some of the things the other groups have also talked about. In specific discussions was that uniform and consistent policies regarding to education and educational technology should be there in the country. This was not very specific to the NMEICT project, but it was a general point that came out in the discussion. If I take the last one as an overarching suggestion that came out, and probably this suggestion is for all the four groups, probably it will come out, that there is a need for a standing committee of the MHRD on issues related to technology in education. I think this is something what was the group three also talked about and others talked about. And when this group was making this suggestion, this came, one thing that came to my mind, and I'm just taking the liberty of sharing this information, that in UK there is something called JISC, Joint Information Systems Committee, which actually decides largely about teaching and learning practices in UK higher education, technology use per se. I think there is a need for something like that at our level, which can form a standing committee and advise, provide guidelines for use of technology in education in general. I think this is what I would like to say. And Janathan, you want to add something?
So my name is Venkatesh Hariharan. I head a nonprofit called Knowledge Commons. On behalf of all the four groups, I'd like to say that the four groups felt that there is a need for an independent body at the national level, possibly called the Digital Education Foundation of India. This representative body should be jointly led by institutions of higher education, public and private corporate sector and NGOs and other stakeholders and supported by the government. The primary role of this body would be to enable digital transformation of India's higher education sector through advocacy and behavioral change and by organizing events and programs and disseminating good practices and toolkits for technology in education. So I would say submit that on behalf of all the four groups. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, so Digital Education Foundation of India is a name that was suggested.
No, I think that is something different. You know,
but we'll that,
this
that,
is an idea.
Yeah, this is an idea we'll park for the moment because our original ambition for what we wish to achieve from this discussion was slightly different. This comes as a useful suggestion, but I think we need to park it for the moment. Sir, with your permission, I'll request Pawan to provide the general conclusions for the conference as well, and his favorite Mumbai declaration, which he wants to make.
I think you know, as this conference had evolved, we you know, can I request Praveen also to join me?
Yeah, all the three stars.
Yeah. So as the conference proceeded, we thought it may be a good idea to capture all the thoughts, synthesize them together, and bring out a statement which we can appropriately call, or maybe possibly call it as Mumbai statement on use of technology in higher education. And so we worked from 9 o'clock to 11:30, 5-6 of us
last night.
And from 11:30 to 1:30, two of us had a standing meeting. We were standing for 2 hours.
Standing
committee. So, and the outcome of all of it was basically to synthesize what has come from the groups, which the four group moderators have already presented here. I think there are some elements in the Mumbai statement which are not presented as a part of the group report. I'll request Professor Kannan to begin with that, and then I'll say something, and then I'll request Praveen.
Yeah, basically, we will add something, preamble, and then the recommendations of the four groups, and then we will conclude. That's the way this is going to come out. I also want to point out that the points for this discussion, again, that was quite a bit of work. It was initiated by Mr. Agarwal. Then all of us pitched in and then added and so on. That also was, that work was done late nights and early mornings.
Multiple
yeah. Mumbai statement of on use of technology in higher education in India. Although it was done in a very short time, about 3 weeks, and in spite of the short notice, there were 85 vice chancellors, deans, heads of institutions of higher education. There have been 25 NMEICT PIs, about 28 people from corporate sectors and NGOs, 12 key policy makers all attended. Yesterday's morning session set up the stage for discussions in the afternoon. We decided right in the beginning, Mr. Agarwal emphasized right from the beginning, that the main portion of this conference, main aspect of this conference would be the group discussions that happened yesterday. And so yesterday's morning session was so organized to set the stage for that. Okay, and we had Dr. Anup Gupta, distinguished scientist from Microsoft, Dr. Anant Agarwal, Professor MIT and also President EdX, gave keynote speeches yesterday, and Professor Mark Russell, King's College London, gave the keynote speech today. This was organized at IIT Bombay with the Planning Commission and MHRD through NMEICT supporting, and Microsoft Research and British Council sponsoring this. So this was an apt occasion, because now we are talking about can we improve the quality? That is, we have tried with lots of ICT-based technologies. Now we are actually talking about quality through that. Is it possible? We also have lots of research available. IIT Bombay itself has an education technology program in which 20 people are doing PhD in just 3 years. So we are in the cusp of a change. So this seems to be an opportune time. So I am really glad that we got an opportunity to host this at IIT Bombay. I'll hand the mic over to you.
No, so in addition to, you know, the preamble and all that, you know, and the specifics on the four groups that are included, that will be included in the Mumbai statement, there'll be a few expectations, you know, and those expectations are not expectations from the government. That is expectations from the sector as a whole, wherein all stakeholders are involved. The expectation is that while we should encourage, you know, adoption of technology in all institutions of higher education, over the next 5 years, identify and enable 100 institutions of higher education, both public and private institutions, to use technology in the most effective manner and become exemplars in technology-enabled learning and reaching to the global standards. So we need to understand what is happening globally in institutions around the world, like MIT or, you know, in Warwick or any other institution which are doing a good job. And at least 100 of our institutions should try to see how they can reach those standards in use of technology. So that is one expectation. Second expectation is that we have a unique organizational model for higher education in the country, you know, which is the affiliating college system, which has been the main constraint in providing quality education. But it could now be leveraged with the university acting as hubs and colleges as spokes to deliver high quality instruction to students enrolled in hundreds of colleges affiliated to the universities. And that is precisely was the focus of this conference, focusing on technical affiliating universities. This, along with efforts on faculty training at a scale like your, which is a mouthful, you know, T10KT, oh, I got it right, will ensure training 10,000 teachers. You know, such efforts will ensure that the issue of availability of quality faculty in large numbers is somewhat addressed. Thus, the role of affiliating university is redefined under the new paradigm, and such universities will be central and will play a transformative role in quality enhancement in higher education in the country. So that is a central focus on affiliating universities to improve quality of higher education. Third is, you know, I think a review of initiatives under NMICT so far reveals, including QEEE, a presentation was made in the morning where technology is being very intensively used to improve quality, that while engineering field is being adequately covered, other fields of study require specific interventions, learning from this experience, and they could be replicated and with suitable adaptations, and at least 10 fields of study, such action will be initiated in the next 5 years. We already have made some beginning with social work under leadership of Tata Institute of Social Sciences. Their representative attended the two-day event, and they're coming up with a proposal in the next meeting of the Standing Committee and the PAB. So we expect in at least 10 fields of study, we have similar initiatives where more intensive use of technology is facilitated and enabled. Next is massive online open courses. You know, they have potential of reaching a very large segment of learners, both inside and outside the formal higher education system. Some of our institutions of higher education have initiated some efforts in this direction. A lot of work is required to be taken to make them mainstream. This involves setting up necessary platforms, supporting assets for blending them with local support mechanisms, educating teachers, defining models for institutional use, evolving new net pedagogies, and establishing certification mechanisms. It is proposed that all this has to be done on a more organized manner rather than leaving it to institutional efforts. So I'll stop here and request Praveen to
I think I'll take all this opportunity also to propose a vote of thanks before Vidya formally and sir speaks and Vidya formally proposes a vote of thanks. Sir, on the behalf of ministry, I'd like to thank both Professor Fatak and Professor Kannan. They were one-stop portal for all of us. They did. they really arranged this program for us. Pawan sir was a booting arrangement for all of us. Yes. He started everything, sir. Sir, as you keep telling me again and again in the ministry, and I would like to reiterate in front of everybody that the core of technology-enabled learning has to be the connectivity and the networks in the network in the university and the colleges. That will be our central focus. We will spend for the mission more time to see that we provide a robust network and the connectivity to all the colleges and universities. So Professor Kincha is here. In his evaluation report, he mentioned about integrating the private sector, the best in private sector, both at the PAB level and at our APEX committee level, which sir has been accepted. This recommendation has been accepted. We'll be adding from the private sector representatives both in APEX as well as in PAB. However, sir, the need here was that apart from the representatives who are there in our NMEICT from the private sector, there will be an independent body which will primarily look at these issues of technology-enabled learning, do the advocacy of technology-enabled learning. We'll have representatives from the government and from the private sector, and then we'll work both with the government and the private sectors and the university. But that's also, sir, one of the recommendations of this technology-enabled learning. Also, sir, in this meeting, sir, I would like to say that you have been a great support to us to this technology-enabled learning. I'd like to share with all of you, I have not done PhD like Professor Fatak or Professor Kannan, but I can get a feel of when a person does a PhD. Technology-enabled learning is a subject which is so new. One day you fresh up, you get up and say you can do everything, and the next day you have another meeting and you realize that nothing can be done. I mean, one of my friend who was doing PhD explained me this, that in when one does PhD, these are the experiences and feel. And you have been always a support to me. I remember the last meeting which we had with BSNL. I was very extremely depressed after the meeting, and you said, no, there's a hope. You must keep working towards it. And I said, sir, before you came, I also told this gathering that we are at the tipping point for the engineering education. And if we don't succeed in this, technology-enabled learning in India at a national level initiative will be very, very difficult to succeed in other areas. In your presence, I solicit the support of all the representatives of state technical universities who are present to make it success so that the technology-enabled learning remains as a big thing and makes a difference in the life of the students of our country.
So I think, how do we take this Mumbai statement forward? So a draft of this is now available. This is a draft form. And we'll request first the coordinators or the moderators of the group and those who made presentations, because your report has been slightly, reworked to tweaked. So you kindly validate whether all your points are included or not. So kindly give us a feedback in 48 hours, okay? And then Professor Kannan, you will go through it, and then we will run it by, Dr. Anup Gupta, our guest from abroad, Professor Mark Russell, and maybe Anant Agrawal, to get their inputs as well. And we'll post it on the web in the draft form. Then for a few days, you can give your comments, and after that, we'll request, sir, if we could formally release it from New Delhi. if the code of conduct does not come into play. So I think, and one of the ideas which was also discussed and we felt very strongly about is that this entire space of learning science is becoming, very, very interesting space. And the world is trying to figure out how the technology will play out in the field of higher education. So in the field of education. So maybe we could think in terms of setting up an inter-institutional center, you know, which brings in expertise on the brain science from psychology, sociology, and educational technology, and so that India can be at the forefront in the creation of knowledge on learning sciences. So this was one area which can be supported under NMICT, and I would now personally on my behalf to organize this event was in some ways a dream for me, personal dream, which I've been thinking for over a year now. And we had chance meeting with Vidya and others who really worked very hard to put it all together. And I was waiting for Praveen to join in the ministry. And even before he joined, I told him we have to have such an event. I'm so grateful that Praveen and sir, we got your support in putting it together. I'm personally grateful to our guests from overseas, you know, Dr. Anup and Mark Russell and Anant, who participated in the conference. I think they really added a global perspective on what's happening in this particular space. And if we work together, and I want to recall one of the slides, you know, in which he was describing, Mark was describing what is ICT. It's not information and communication technology alone. It is information and connective, collaborative technology or connective technology. I think we have connected together in these 2 days in a way to work out and synthesize, to develop some kind of a vision, which is not a government vision. The Mumbai statement is not essentially a government policy document. You know, we want it to be co-owned by all of us, by this community, and as we move forward, by the larger academic community and by all stakeholders. And we create a vision for use of technology to address some of the challenges that India's higher education sector faces. So I'll end here, sir, and thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Pawan. A very short conclusion. May I request Vidya to join me?
We also have Richard from British Council. You know, we'll request him to join us.
Yes. Yeah, I forgot. Richard, can you join us? This is a very pleasant job of expressing a vote of thanks. The reason I have called Vidya, you must realize that there were multiple organizers of this conference. It was kicked off by Pawan's initiative. And somebody spoke about the chance meeting. I now understand his method of working. He had a chance meeting with me over lunch in Delhi, and he imposed this entire conference organization within that span. Frankly, I have organized many conferences, but never in my life I have attempted to organize a conference in 3 weeks, where the conference program was still getting developed as the conference was getting arranged. I have done it once, thanks to God and thanks to a lot of people. I don't think I'll ever do it again. So, Pawan, you'll give at least 6 months' notice for a good call. Anyway, first of all, I would like to thank the Microsoft Research and British Council, and that is why I requested Vidya and him to Richard to come here for helping us so well. I think you've wrongly call them sponsors of this conference. They are not.
They are partners of this conference.
That is what we have called them, and that is what we believe they have worked as. So thank you so much. Thank you. Let's give them a big hand for helping us. I already thanked Sri Ashok Thakur, Secretary of Higher Education, for coming here personally. I already mentioned that how grateful we are all for him. Not only for coming here today, but for supporting us continuously all these years. And we hope this support will continue in future without any doubt. I would like to thank the Vice Chancellors and the senior colleagues from the state technical universities and some of the leaders from autonomous colleges for making time. As Pawan rightly said, this whole conference is about all of us taking the ownership of whatever we wish to do in future. And I'm glad that many of you came. I understand that there is another important conference happening for all the university vice chancellors, and that is why several could not come. But many have sent their representatives, and I am sure that they will take back the message. But thank you so much for attending this conference. I must also thank NITTRs, all the directors and their senior colleagues are here, for helping us doing a whole lot of components of the organizational things here. Especially officials from MHRD and Planning Commission. I would like to name Dr. Arora for organizing things at that end, and Bharat Bhushan, who diligently arranged to send invitations one after another. That was another nightmare, I must admit. He had told me that the conference will be attended by 60 people. The invitations became 80, then they became 120, they became 160. And when I saw 196, I went mad. But then statistics helped us. And about 50 to 60% people actually attend, so that is how we were able to manage that. But anyway, thank you so much for organizing. There are no words I have that at very short notice, very senior people from both within the country and elsewhere came and participated and shared their knowledge. I'd begin by thanking Dr. Mantha, Chairman AICT, Professor Raghavan. Both of them gave their talks in the inaugural portion. We had excellent keynotes by Dr. Anup Gupta and Dr. Anand Agarwal yesterday. Interesting comments by Jill Caldicott. Is Jill here?
No, she's left.
I would like to thank Dr. Jagdish Arora for sharing with us the exciting work that they're doing in FlipNeb. Dr. Andrew, Pankaj and Sujata, Lina and Uma, Dr. Anandan, and all the SEDA reporters, because as we mentioned to you, these deep discussions for 2.5 hours that each group did was the crux and heart of this conference. That is what we wanted. I would specifically like to thank Professor Mark Russell and Professor Kincha, my friend, for coming here all the way. Professor Mark Russell's thing, I have noted that you have mentioned things that we ought to do after listening to you. They are noted. I'll be personally doing all of those things. At the end, I must thank a large number of people in my team in IIT Bombay here. I have requested some of the senior managers of the team to come here. Could they please just stand so that I can acknowledge them and their contributions? My team members, will they please stand, all the team members? Thank you so much. As I said, it was a nightmare, but this nightmare was made possible by the excellent work done by the team. These stalls were organized in the last 5 days. I would request you that as you have lunch, you all have, of course, flights to catch and so on, but please do spend at least 5 to 10 minutes going through these stalls. You do not know how much it will encourage those people. Secretary of Higher Education himself has spent the time on visiting all the stalls. I request each one of you to visit the stalls. Of course, those of you who are interested in visiting the labs later, those options people will be collecting and the arrangements will be made.
Professor Patak, Pawan Agarwalji from the Minister Planning Commission. Actually, we don't really realize how fortunate we are to have in the 11th five-year plan this particular scheme. It's 5,000 crore rupees scheme. And let me just tell you that never in my life have I encountered such a scheme. I don't know how it got passed from the cabinet, actually. Incidentally, I was attending on that day the cabinet. R.P. Agarwal Sahab, he was not there that day. I was very petrified because it's totally so innovative that it's scary. But fortunately, the mood then was very positive because of the overall growth in the economy. All the cabinet members were gung-ho about whatever they were doing, and because of that, we have this project. Let me tell you that you realize how important it is for the economy to grow. At the root cause, the crux of everything is the economy. If your economy is not growing, forget about such projects. You'll never get such projects. Then you'll have some government schemes here and there which totally bind your hands, feet, everything, and you can't do anything. So this is a particular project which is so innovative, so therefore it is our responsibility to please to make sure that this scheme is used with all sincerity of purpose and all the efforts at our command to make it successful. We are very fortunate that the IIT system has adopted the scheme. If you look at the initial proposal of the NMAICT project, it mentions about premier institutions, but the role of IITs has come voluntarily. And that is something which I really appreciate. Till now, the IITs have been basically, my experience is that they, in the past, they have been working only amongst themselves. But this is such a good departure, wherein they are trying to reach out to the universities. Last time, Praveen, our Joint Secretary, organized a signing of MOU of all the state technical universities and all your the IIT partners in this great project were also there. So this is for the first time that now IITs are openly reaching out. The standards which they have developed over the past 50 years, they wanted to share it with the rest of the world. And then for us, it becomes very easy. I was speaking to Agarwal Sam that we feel very safe when we feel that this whole project, NMAICT project, is being steered by the IITs. On the part of the universities, I think it's in a way very fortunate that most of the state governments have now created state technical universities. Earlier, the subjects were, there were lots of other universities and it would have become very difficult for us to coordinate. But now we have a ready-made platform in each state through the technical universities. So we really need to work very, very closely with the technical universities, because ultimately whatever we're doing here has to percolate down, not only at the level of the vice chancellors of these universities, which has been attempted today, we had made an attempt earlier also, but also at the level of faculty and then at the level of the students. Now that is the ultimate test. Each of your products which you talk about, whether it's a virtual lab or whether it's a talk to a teacher program, whether there's any other program, all these stalls which you see abroad, each and every student in India should know. Anybody who is pursuing a program in engineering should know that these things are there. So that is a big challenge. We need to see how we can take it forward. Each and every institution, I think, whether it's a university or a college, should have in their web portal a link or whatever to our Sakshat portal and whatever we are doing here. I think that's very, very important. Students should be aware. That is something very important, I feel, and I'm very pleased that we seem to be making headway on this. In the years to come, in the months to come, I would like to see that more such interaction, whether you can't have physical interaction all the time with 700 universities, but through the virtual mode, we should have as much interaction as possible through the IITs. The second thing which I have been requesting Professor Phatak and our members on the PAB is that whatever we are creating through the NMAICT project today needs to be used through an institutionalized mechanism on a sustainable manner. Because otherwise, any MAICT project is not there for forever. So we need to create mechanisms by which arm's length body could be created within, to begin with, probably Professor Fatak should take the lead on that. A body, yes, an arm's length body, an independent arm's length body in IIT Bombay, which starts, and it should have a governing body, which should have full powers to see how to take it forward, all these things which you are creating here.
And we give him 1 year advance to organize the next big conference, not 6 months.
So, I think that's very important. Otherwise, the project money will dry up, and then at the end of the day, you are left high and dry. Yeah. Very, very important. So, I hope we will be able to work on this seriously. Whatever assistance you want from us in creating an autonomous body which actually is able to generate resources too. It cannot be permanently dependent on government. That is a warning I'm telling you again and again. Resources anyway, I face the planning commission is less this thing, but the expenditure secretary, some of you have tasted them. You know, it's very difficult the rate at which the things are happening in the country. Resources may not be so easily available now. Years to come, unless we really, so whatever we have to do it in a very proper way, and have a mechanism by which we can use, we can generate resources and make optimum use of it. I think we need to really also work. Today, I did not see anybody from the University Grants Commission. Now, whether we like it or not, if you want to deal with the outside world, the IT system, you have to deal with this guy called UGC. It's a very cussed customer, it doesn't react very easily, it takes a lot of time, but you have to deal with him. Because it is the UGC which sets the standards, whether even for distance education. So therefore, if you want to do anything with the universities, we have to have UGC on board. We will see through the government, ensure that whatever programs the IITs are not everybody, we're going to be very, very restrictive as far as MOOCs kind of education we are trying to promote, limited. To begin with, we will see whatever IIT Bombay is doing. And then we will ensure that credits are given through UGC's regulation to all these colleges and universities. So that means through a regulation of UGC, we will ensure that for the program which he is starting on trial basis, credits are given so the students get, this whole system should get accepted by the university system. That is very, very important. We should also see that teachers who are adopting the modern ICT technologies, way of teaching, they're getting trained, etc., should get some incentive in terms of now UGC has come up with these API scores. I will ensure that credit should be given at something for those teachers. So the teachers who are more avant-garde in their way of looking at things, way of teaching, etc., which Professor Fatak has started unleashed from here, faculty members should get. We should also have a look within the distance education system which UGC have to create a counterpart of GIST. Of course, the IITs are autonomous, they can do within their own system, they can do, but as far as the rest of the world is concerned, it is the UGC which has to come out with these regulations. So I'm extremely very grateful today to Professor Fatak especially, to the Planning Commission, to British Council, Microsoft Research, and IIT Bombay for giving this opportunity. And I think it's so exciting to be here and see that education in India is really moving towards a new direction. It is so exciting. And then very shortly we are going to start 50 DTH channels. That is another very exciting area. And I think all of you here, I would request you people to be center stage in taking this 50 DTH channels also forward as much as possible, anchored purely, mainly in the IIT system. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I have pleasure in declaring the conference closed. I invite everybody to have lunch. As I said, please do visit the stalls, however briefly, because that will encourage all the people there. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Very, very small.